Hello everyone and welcome to a very impressive game that was played in 2020 in the Russian Championship between Daniil Dubov and Sergey Karjakin. Now if you're wondering why is it this particular game I'm choosing, I haven't really chosen this particular game. I just wanted to show a Dubov game and this one came to mind. But why did I want to choose a Dubov game? Well, if you go online, you know, from time to time, and especially if you use Twitter, you probably have seen this. It's a tweet by Sergey Karjakin. He says, "Of course, I congratulate a world champion, but just a small remark. Imagine you have to play a world championship match against Carlsen. Will you accept help from, let's say, Hammer or Tari, as they are both Norwegian, in the same way that Magnus accepted help from Daniil Dubov, who is Russian?" And here it's kind of a, well, it could be a little bit weird because Jan Nepomniachtchi is also Russian, and to them, it seems a little bit weird that a Russian would be helping a non-Russian to beat a Russian. Obviously, Karjakin is weirded out by this a little bit, but Dubov doesn't really care. Just does his thing, and he is very happy that he was able to be a part of Team Magnus, because Magnus never reveals who his seconds are before the end of the World Chess Championship match, and it was the same this year, and his seconds were, most of them were the same as in the previous one against Caruana, so Lauren Fresnay, Peter Heinen Nielsen, he had Jan Gustafsson and Daniil Dubov as the the young one who is able to bring chaos into all of this, and Jordan van Forest. We did not see him as a second by the World Championship champions team so far. So now that the team has been revealed, of course, some of the Russians probably are not happy. But I've seen an interview, I think, with Nepo before the match even started, that he will not be inviting Dubov, as he knows that he was Carlsen second in his match against Caruana, so he doesn't want to put him in an awkward position to have to choose between being Team Nepo or Team Carlsen. So I don't know what's all the fuss about. I mean, Dubov himself said that looking at it like this is very short-sighted, because Dubov is one of the strongest players in the world, and after working with Carlsen during his match with Fabiano Caruana, he came out of it much stronger, and he won the World Rapid Championship. So we'll see if Dubov improved further, and will he do well in this year's World Rapid and Blitz Championship, which I don't know if you've heard has been cancelled, but not altogether. It's just been relocated from Kazakhstan to Poland, so it's still gonna happen, I believe, from 21st to 26th of December, but I'm still gonna get back to that. So this was just an intro about why I wanted to show a Dubov game, as there was a lot of drama about that. So I've already shown the most impressive game from 2020. It's not officially the greatest game of 2020, but I think it is, Dubov versus Karjakin from the Russian Championship, I think round 11. Do check it out, the first link in the description below. It's just a masterpiece of a game. It has the delayed Evans Gambit, it has everything. I don't want to spoil it if any of you haven't seen it, but okay, enough with the intro, let's check it out. This is quite an impressive one. So Dubov opens with d4. We have knight to f6, c4, e6, knight to f3, and now we have d5. So going for the queen's gambit declined. Let me just check something real quickly. I wanted to mention. This is. If you guys are wondering, this is a rapid game from the Lindoris Abbey rapid tournament, but I'm sure you guys know that. So here we have d5, knight to c3, and now bishop to e7. So just a normal three knights variation of the queen's gambit. Declined, we have bishop to g5 by Dubov, knight b to d7, e3, and h6. So again, this has all been played before many, many times, and bishop back to h4 is a standard idea here. But the Dubov plays bishop back to f4, and it seems like he has some fishy ideas here that might be unpleasant for a rapid game. So Karjakin obviously not worried about about that. He just castles. But now Dubov shows that he is not interested in attacking the queen side. He's actually interested in attacking the king side. And here, normally you would see a move like bishop d3 and castles, but Dubov just plays g4. He says, I'm going to play g5. I'm going to open up the g5, put the rook on g1, and now my bishop being on f4 makes perfect sense. So how can Karjakin deal with this? Well, obviously, he can't capture a pawn. If you capture a pawn, rook g1, and you're already in a terrible, terrible position. If you move the knight, bishop captures on h6 is terrible. And if h5, we can just kick away the knight with h3. Let's say knight goes back. We can even play c5, and black really has no moves. White controls all the squares, and it's only a matter of time. This knight is coming to e5. You can never capture here, otherwise captures, and then the queen captures on h5, and so on. This will be impossible to hold for black. So, of course, Karjakin knows all of this. He just plays c5. He says, I don't believe in your attack. I'm just going to attack the center, and this is a very principled idea, as Dubov's king is in the center of the board, so we want to open up the center. We have g5. Dubov continues his attack. We have h captures, knight captures, and now c captures on d4. Again, very principled decision. You want to open up the center. Queen to b6 is the strongest move here, but it's a rapid game. We will not be exploring that. So c captures on d4, e captures on d4, and now d captures on c4. So he made some progress in opening up the center, but Dubov just continues his attack with rook to g1. And okay, knight to d5, we're putting some pressure on the knight here, and now queen to c2. Dubov even encourages this capture on g5 because he's threatening checkmate on h7. And you can't really play g6. If g6, then knight captures on f7, and that's it. Rook captures, queen captures on g6, and it's all over. You can't go here because of queen g8 checkmate, so you have to move. Then we capture the rook, and queen h5 will be game over. So after queen to c2, we have bishop captures on g5. We have to eliminate one of the attackers. Bishop captures, and now f6. This is one of the positions where it's actually okay to play f6, attacking the bishop, and now bishop to h6. Dubov is now threatening rook captures on g7. Rook to f7, defending, and now do you castle or do you go for bishop captures on c4? Well, both moves kind of have to be played, so I guess it doesn't matter all that much which order you go by. So bishop captures on c4, and now what do you do here? Well, white is the one who's attacking here, so can black just remove one of the attackers, let's say with knight captures on c3. Usually this is a good idea. When you're under attack, you want to eliminate as many attackers as possible. And even though, okay, you might say this is not an attacker because it's all the way on c3, well, it can get to e4 very, very, very quickly, and then it might be, you know, a troublesome piece. So what would happen if knight captures on c3 is just bishop captures on e6, and now it seems like, okay, queen e7, I pin your bishop, that's it. Now I win the game. The problem is now there's a rook captures on g7 because the rook on f7 is also pinned. So after the king moves, and you can't go here. If you go here, queen to h7 is still checkmate. So you're going to have to go here. Now we capture here with a double check, and now you just fall apart. King e8, we're going to capture here. You lost the queen, and you're going to lose pretty much everything else. Captures, captures, and captures, and white, of course, is completely winning here. So we can't eliminate any attackers just yet. So Karjakin goes knight 7 to b6. Now he opens up the bishop here, and the queen will be able to maybe help out with the control of some of the squares. So bishop back to e2 as the bishop was attacked here, and now f5, not allowing the queen to have any access that is diagonal, and only now Dubov castles queen side. We have queen to h4, now putting some pressure on the h2 pawn, on the f2 pawn, some pressure on this pawn. Okay, for the moment it's defended, but a lot of pressure by the queen on h4. So bishop to g5, Dubov now even forces a capture, and you can't really play just anything here. Capturing on h2, rook h1, you don't want to give that rook the open h file. So he captures on f2, but it's pretty much the same. Now we play queen to d2, and this is a very important move, queen to d2. If you just go rook to f1, then queen captures on d4 is very, very unpleasant. So it's important to solidify at least a little bit before attacking. So queen d2, we defend our pawn, and now what do you play? Well, you could eliminate, again, one of the pieces by captures, but it doesn't really help black's position all that much. This knight isn't really doing anything. If you put it to d5, we can even play c4. It has to go back, and you still have to develop your bishop and the rook on a8. So again, this capture really does nothing. So instead, we have bishop to d7. Of course, Karjakin wants to bring the rook to c8, and then it will be an excellent piece. So now we have rook d to f1 attacking the queen, and now the queen has to capture on h2. So queen captures on h2. We have rook to h1, and now queen to d6. So now what can white do? Well, white has to attack. Otherwise, he's just lost. Black is up too much. So here we have rook to h3, preparing rook to h1, and then we want to deliver checkmate with rook to h8. So here Karjakin plays knight captures on c3, but now it's a very tricky position. Feel free to pause the video and win the game for Dubov while I give you a couple of seconds. So for those of you who were able to do it, congratulations on not capturing this knight, and especially not capturing this knight with the queen, you know, rook to c8 and stuff. But for those of you who decided to play rook f to h1, congratulations, that is now, a very difficult position for black to defend. So congratulations once again. And what can black do here? Well, rook to h8 is the threat of checkmate, so he has to do something about this. So Karjakin tries knight captures on e2 with check. He grabbed one piece here. Now he grabs another one with check. First, we have to react to this, and then we're going to worry about checkmate. So queen captures on e2, and now if you play rook c8 check, king b1, there's no continuation here for black. So he has to try queen to c6 check, and now he wants to give up the queen for the rook on h1. Although there was the sneaky defense of maybe just the rook to f6. But okay, it's a rapid game. Queen to c6 check. We have king to b1, and now queen captures on h1. Again, rook to f6 here still works. We can free up the f7 square for our king, but it's still not going to be an easy game. Bishop captures on f6, and now we play queen to e4 check. We force a queen trade here. Captures, and now let's say rook g3. We go after the pawn. After the king moves, we can capture here. And if, let's say, rook g8, we can play rook to h7, and it's, white is up the exchange. Black is up a pawn. White should be able to win this, you know, especially in a rapid game. In a classical, maybe black defends, but it's hard to say. So, giving up the rook with rook to f6 allows Karjakin to survive the attack, but it's a very hard decision to make. So here, queen captures on h1 was played. Rook captures on h1. Now bishop to c6, attacking the rook, preparing to bring the other rook into the game. Now rook to h4, still with ideas of maybe queen h5, queen to h8, checkmate. So bishop to e4 with check, king to a1, and now rook to c8. Now it's a very dangerously placed rook, but luckily the bishop on g5 is guarding the c1 square, so there's that. But Dubov here just played queen to h2, and he was in this position on move 30 that Sergei Karjakin resigned the game, as there is nothing more to be done here. So that rook to f6 was the only way that he could have defended this position, but now the threat of rook h8 is just too great, and there is no defense against that. If you try rook to f6 now, you can prolong it a little bit, but we're just going to trade it like this. Rook h8, king f7, we're going to capture here. After captures, we capture here. And after king captures, yes, you do have a bishop and knight for a queen, but let's say queen b8 attacks the knight and the pawn here, so once you move the knight, captures here, and then the pawns simply become unstoppable. That's pretty much game. You have nothing more to look for here with black. So, of course, Karjakin knows this, and after this queen to h2, he resigned the game. So, very impressive win by Dubov. I know you guys have requested a Dubov game for quite some time now, so I decided to show this one. But in case you haven't seen the greatest game played in 2020, do check it out. It's also between these two gentlemen, but there is a lot more fireworks there, and also that's a classical game, so it makes it all the more impressive. That's the game. Hope you guys enjoyed it. First link in the description below. If you haven't seen it, do check it out. Or if you have, you know, rewatch it. I know you guys also enjoy that. I would like to thank David Kimura, Peter Stoltz, CustomChess.com, Gerard V. Beck, and CapsLog.ac for a contribution to my channel. Thank you a lot. I really appreciate it. As usual, you can check two of my previous videos here. Thank you all for watching, and I will see you soon, continuing to check up on your wonderful suggestions and whatever else happens in the chess world. So thank you all. I will see you soon, and have an excellent rest of your day.